And we stop recording during the break, and we will stop recording when Agatha's on, because we don't want to upset her friends. Okay, so I'm going to start by reading you a poem. Can you all hear me?
Yeah.
Right.
Are we all to mute?
I don't mind if you mute or not. If you're going to make a lot of noise, I'd prefer, but I don't mind if you don't mute. Where's my poem gone? Oh no, my poem's gone. Sorry, it's a bit of a disaster happening here, isn't there? Bear with me. Oh dear. Right. Okay. I'm in the process of putting together a new book. I don't know when it's going to be published. I'm just working on it at the moment. But I've got some poems from it. And for those that don't know me, my name is Peter Lay. And I am the events, whatever, what's my title? I've forgotten, Jason.
Event
organizer or something for the Gloucestershire Poetry Society. Yes, Michael. Did you hold your hand up? No. Okay.
I was just like,
meh. Yeah. And so I'm going to start with a quick poem that it's called Somewhere New. I had a conversation with somebody who said they were struggling to write some new poetry. And I just said, think of a place where you've always wanted to go, but never actually got there. And then promptly forgot all about it. That person forgot all about it and wrote something completely different. And then about 6 months later, I suddenly remembered and I wrote this poem. It's not that long. It's just an introduction. It's called Somewhere New. Okay. I have a list that will never be completed and never fully deleted. I have never been to the city of Cadiz, the oldest city in Western Europe, famous for its many watchtowers scattered around the city, beautiful beaches, sunny climate, and for acting as Cuba in James Bond's Die Another Day. I would take you there to this small atmospheric city, to walk the narrow cobbled streets, eat tapas on street corners, enjoy flamenco, the dancers, and the rhythm of the guitars. Revel in its beauty, kiss under the stars. Thank you. That's just an opening poem for you. Okay, we're gonna... Thank you, Jason. I just picked that message up. We're gonna start now with Michael Sindler, all the way from the United States. And over to you, Michael. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. I'm gonna try and fit in a couple fairly short ones here in my 3 minutes. Just
go for it.
First one, being how it is Women's Week, which should all be all year long, of course. I'll start with this. It's an ode to Shekinah. Mother of all, we see you in all, each rounded hill, your beating bosom, milk of your heart, and each sweet fruit, your coursing power running through wave, wind, and earthly tremor, fierce, untamed mistress, holding all life in gentle arms of green, your beauty bursting in infinite color and infinite scent and infinite texture, arousing all affection, all rush to valor. We ache in every aspect of our essence to once again be one with you. The deep womb of the grave itself only brings us closer to rebirth in new form. O Aphrodite, O Kali, O Avalokiteshvara, release your Shakti and your compassion. Only through you is life made true. And do another one. That this is called Pretend to Know. I cannot pretend to know your pain, to feel the history you hold strapped across bent shoulders, your skin itself a warning sign of victimhood, indelible excuse inciting the ignorant to violence. I cannot pretend to feel the thousand daily pricks as eyes cut with unwarranted suspicion, the sense of being surveilled with each step, the knowledge that you need not give pretense of intent to end up silenced forever by authority's smoking gun, bullet justified by fear, perpetrator excuse because color equals danger. I cannot pretend to have been turned down over and over for jobs, for loans, for housing, for a seat at the table of justice, over and over and over, surrounded by red line districting, pinning your potential into lock food deserts, overtaxed and underprotected, where buses stop running in early evening. I cannot and will not pretend that this recitation of what I see and hear is equal to experience. I can walk away, my privilege dragging behind like a long shadow at dusk, smug in my illusion of understanding, my pale attempt at empathy, while you shake your head with mixed disdain and pity, half happy to have an ally and half inured to know how often alliance is only skin deep when the upper hand is asked to level itself in balance and lose leverage's advantage. I do not know much, but I know that I do not know much. I cannot, I will not pretend to know your pain. Okay, thank you all very much.
Thank you, Michael. Can a big hand for Michael Sindler, please. Thank you. Excellent. Privilege dragging as long shadow, that is. Wow, that's a line for you. I think somebody already wrote that in there. Yeah, Agatha. Yeah, great minds think alike. Okay, so next up we have a slight change in order. We have Pratibha Castle. And you're somewhere down near the south coast, I believe, Pratibha.
Yes, yes. Just 5 minutes west of Arundel.
Ah.
Close, yeah.
Not quite so close to the coast.
Well, 10 minutes drive.
Closer than us.
yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Okay. Pratibha Castle. Okay.
Thank you. So this week, my book finally launched, A Triptych of Birds and a Few Loose Feathers by Hedgehog Press. Yay. So I'm going to read something from it tonight. It was dedicated, or it is dedicated, to my mother. And I'm going to read a poem that a little bit was inspired by her, but it's mostly fictional, if I can find it. So new, I'm not so used to finding my way around it. Okay, there we go. Some of you have heard it before. Wild Lass of Kells. She shuffles on the curb outside O'Shaughnessy's, corner of Kelly and Dunleavon Road. Her eyes the colour of Our Lady's veil, scorched bluer by her copper curls. On the lookout for the da, her task of a Friday night to wheedle the wages off of him before he sets out on the lash, glad of a break from the chores, socks like a flock of crows forever jostling, hand-me-down frocks in need of hems, pants snagged on barbed wire, nails atop of farmers' walls and fences. Herself the firstborn of a baker's dozen, endless mopping up of spats, snail snots, scabby porridge pots. Licks of laughter, yellow light, sidle out the gaping door into the night, let out by kulchis on their shuffle to the bar. Egits with purple slurs for eyes, glances tossed her way, collection plate clink of small change at Sunday mass. The odd time, a flash of lust, the most times shame. a rare smile to build her up. Sure, aren't you a dote now, Delia, looking out for your mammy? God bless yourself. Eyes cast down, pious daughter of the Virgin, Lord love the child in her wilting dress, miraculous blue medal clipped to the chest of her tatty cardigan. An occasion of sin, to be sure, Slovenes might take advantage of. Till she glances up, that glare, brazen as hell's fires, from the child of Mari of the Scry Eye, seventh daughter of a seventh son. Flame hex of a wild blood tinker. Skipping off home to a last scald of the pot, wedge of soda farl thick with dripping, her pocket is a clatter of coins, only the lighter by a bleary-eyed pint.
Thank you, Fatima.
Thank you. Is it okay if I put the details of where to get it in the chat?
Just going to say that. Put the details in the chat. And if anybody wants to get Petiba's book or have a look at Petiba's book, you can find out all about it when she puts it in the chat. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Big hand for Petiba Castle. Okay. Next, we have Margaret Royal, who's also just had a book out. So
bit of a while back now. Anyway, well, January, yes, had the launch in January. Some of you have heard this, apologies to those who have. It's a bit of a fantasy one. I've always quite fancied being one of the Bloomsbury set, you know, Vanessa Bell and Virginia Woolf. There was a whole series on television. And I actually went to visit the Charleston farmhouse where they hung out during the war. And I wrote a poem about it. I went with a friend who wasn't very well on the day. So that gives you to the background. Hanging out with the Bloomsbury set. This is a fantasy encounter. Sorry, I'm losing it. Fantasy encounter with Vanessa Bell and Virginia Woolf. You sat on the iron bench beside the trailing roses in your yellow raincoat, troubled by a migraine, content to let me wander at will, to abandon myself to this bohemian extravaganza. Water boatmen skated on lily pads, drenched by a sudden shower. The simmer of Sunday visitors hummed in and out of the farmhouse, wasps flitting from rotten apples to honey cake, striped caterpillars gorging on young oak leaves. Inside, I marveled at plump nudes on muted backdrops, relieved by random slashes of crimson lipstick. This phantasmagoria drugged my senses, awakened a desire to fling brushes and paint at the studio walls. For so long, I had imagined meeting them, flouting convention, immersing myself in this avant-garde vibe, succumbing to hallucinations, rush of adrenaline coursing my veins. Outside, a clattering of jackdaws, sparrows quarrelling round the old cattle trough, light falling on the old sundial by the woodshed. You sat so patiently there on the iron bench beside the trailing roses in your yellow raincoat, waiting for the migraine to pass, smiling as I emerged from the farmhouse, my intoxication plain to see. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Margaret. Big hand for Margaret. Okay. Now, I'm not quite sure what's happening next, but it's going to be a bit different, I think. This is a slightly longer open mic slot, as it was agreed. So we have, are you actually in Greece, Alexandra?
Yes, we are actually in Greece, yes.
You are in Greece, so all the way from Greece. Alexandra Saropoulou? No, sorry. Can you say your name? Sorry.
It's Saropoulou, but that's because there's a tripod letter in Greek which combines P and S together.
Ah.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Okay, so this is a visual thing, and I think there might even be some music accompaniment. But it's
there is a live guitar accompaniment.
Okay.
And Michael Clive and Kate have heard it before.
Okay. Go for it.
My visions are my torture. My visions are my comfort. Turquoise visions, turquoise line. For those whose hearts are not tired of sowing in the field of dreams. For the journey is bittersweet, half hurt, half tenderness. Like thorny milk thistle, like sweet smelling jasmine. Accepting variety and different behaviors. Going beyond wrongdoings and rightdoings into new and more thriving harvests. My visions are my scrambling ascent. My visions are my sacred conquest. Turquoise visions, turquoise flying. For those whose hearts can admire the phosphorescent hopes of the sunset. For the journey is rugged, half uphill, half downhill. Like bare time in the winter cold, like bees gathering nectar from spring blossoms. Evoking the rain's lament and the sun's caress. Going beyond unpleasant and pleasant reactions onto new and even higher peaks. My visions are my futile mirages. My visions are my sweetest oases. Turquoise visions, turquoise lines. For those whose hearts are refreshing fountains of muses' songs. For the journey is uncharted, half tempest, half tranquility. Like a wavy, turbulent sea on a windy day, like crystal, serene waters under the shimmering sun. Sailing over low and high tides, going beyond traumatic and fond memories into new and longed for harbors. My visions are my lightning duty. My visions are my radiant basking. Turquoise visions. Turquoise flying. For those whose hearts shine brightly through storms. For the journey is evolving, half empirical, half innate. Seeing what I encounter, seeing what I know. Painting the world in dark and iridescent hues. Going beyond detrimental and beneficial beliefs into new and more exquisite rainbows. Our visions are our unmanifested ashes. Our visions are our golden wings. Golden visions, golden flying.
Thank you. Well, that was interesting. That was very different from what we normally have, and great. It's really good to have new stuff coming through, people looking at poetry in different ways. So a big hand for Alexandra, and the guitarist and the artist and everything. There, yeah, there you go. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Okay, moving on. On my list, I've got Cynthia Winfield, who I believe is not here. There was a question mark over her. So we'll move on to Vicky Hampton, if that's okay, Vicky. You're here somewhere, I'm sure. You were here.
Trouble with the mute button. As we have a bus driver amongst us this evening, I thought I'd read a poem that I wrote about various bus drivers that used to pass me on a road that is a mile and a half long that I used to walk every morning. I used to have a lift with my lodger to the bottom every morning and then walk the mile and a half back up just for some exercise. And the bus drivers they kept me entertained, let's put it that way. So this is called Bus Driver. In the lane, Friday's Jack the Lad, wolf whistles going past. His mind is on a tail back of lasses, but he still eyes me 50 in the wing mirror. Monday, he stares ahead, mean-mouthed, sallow-skinned as a wintering Italian. A half expect a cigarette between his slit lips, wind flicking ash through the window. I'll bet there's a little wife who's tried everything to make the sun shine. Yesterday, despite drizzle, there was a breeziness to the man. His ruddy face, like blushes in the back of a school bus, beamed, and the wheel slid easy through his podgy fingers. He was singing as it steered a greasy line over his jolly belly, and he waved, and I waved back.
That was quite short, Vicky. Have you got another one? You're muted.
Thank you, Peter. I don't immediately know. I was trying to just keep the timing down. But if there's time, I'll read another for you later.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, moving on. I think Leslie hasn't joined us yet. So we'll move on to Julie Stevens, please.
Thank you, Peter. All the winds that we've had recently made me think of this poem, and walking with two sticks, the wind kind of took hold of me and it gave me a joy. I didn't fall over, but it made me move in a way, a quicker way than what I normally would. This is called Running is a Prize. And just like that, I can run, as wild as that dog's fuel scraping the sky, wind tipping the field, feet sailing each gust, thumping a dangerous dance forward. Two sticks in hand almost left my side. That dog would be crazed by metal's flight. The squelch of mud moulding each foot, a print that yelped to be framed. The joy of landing never felt so good.
Wow, that's good. Another one?
I can keep on the running theme because, of course, I used to be a runner, and watching people go out running can be a bit of a hard hit sometimes. This is called I'd run with you. Your legs pound the waking air, carry your desperate needs, kick me as I sit still on this long road to recovery. My legs refuse to walk, but time hasn't fixed the brakes, I'm afraid. It sneers as it drags you to the end. I know, because I'm already there, wanting to taste those leaves, feel the air comb through this loss, run up a mountain I can't even climb. It's the worst wait, you coming home. Reminds me again how these legs used to run. I will love you from inside, wrap lycra round my neck and pull tight.
Wow, thank you.
There we go.
Yeah,
good. Thank you.
Okay, moving on. Maybe I should talk about, just briefly talk about Raised Voices. Next Tuesday, some of you are, we have Raised Voices, which is on next Tuesday, which is 8th of March, which is International Women's Day. We have 22 women poets that are reading on Zoom. It's our last live event that we did in the GPS was 2 years ago when we did Raise Voices in St. Mary de Crypt in Gloucester. And we had hoped to do it this year, but there were some concerns still. So, you know, that maybe hopefully will happen next year. But we've got 22 poets, female poets. There is no open mic, so they've been invited. Some of the people here are actually reading. And if you want to come along and support that, it's you'll find the post on the GPS Facebook page. Hi, Leslie.
Hello. Oopsie.
I just saw you down there. Is it a bit soon for you?
Oh, yeah, a little bit soon. Yeah, I'm almost there. Just give me a second.
So that I'll just finish that. Raised Voices next week. It's going to run from 7 till about 10, I think. It's going to be quite a long one. So that's an interesting thing. I can also will you be all right to read in a couple of minutes?
Yes, I will.
Right. Just give you an insight. Next month, Crafty Crows is on 6th of April, Wednesday, 6th of April. And the features are Anna Saunders and Belinda Rimmer. So that's a good one. We've had a bit of a hamdinger. We had Catherine O'Driscoll last month and Emma Pursehouse. Catherine O'Driscoll is the current UK slam champion, I think. And Emma Pursehouse was a previous UK slam champion. That was good. Tonight, we're very lucky because we've got the fabulous Derek Dohren and the incredible Jake Wildeman, who I'm going to introduce shortly after Leslie has done her thing. So I've just filled in there to give you an update on what's coming up. So next week we have Raised Voices, and next month Crafty Crows featuring Anna Saunders and Belinda Rimmer. That will be the post for that. The thing for that where you can apply for open mic slots will go up tomorrow. So.
I am ready.
So without further ado, we'll hand you over for our last open mic of the first half to Leslie Constable. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to read three short ones. This one's called The Wordless State. The reaches of the night sky you left, you cannot now touch, yet only look, and you look. Spirit exiled, sits calm and reaching up, waits knowing it has lifted to the that which is said, that which is left unsaid, even though you cannot touch, yet touch you did. A miracle it could be, but you know better. It is just the is of what we are, that you know and don't know all the while that you are. To touch the wordless, that which is said, but only in the not saying, is not the what is. It is the other side of when there is nothing, the nothing of too much, the nothing of too little, and we, in our wordless state, when the what that is said is not the what is, and when nothing says too much. We know this place. We live with this deep juncture. Our secret is beings that we can, at any moment, transcend the believed and instead be the impulse to be a spirit dancing with the stars in the night sky. My second one is, just give me a second. I will read These Islands. If you reconstruct the land, you have something in your mind, but can you walk on it, extending matter as the long peninsula that from your matter to matter you seduce to be there? And will you wave to me far out on the tip, the point of existence, the white handkerchief flailing in whatever breeze you conjure? Will I wave back or, eyes downcast in that which is my world, simply ponder that which is inside and think briefly of all the times we shared when we did know each other, when we did laugh so hard that we threw our heads back and released into the air this beauty of sound, our laughing, rising up and rising up, working its way up from the toes, or would it be from further down below the line of walking? And what now? You and your island, now alone, when for you time stopped, and you sitting there, knitting and knitting together yourself back into form to keep the soul there with you, warm and steady with you intact. And you don't mention your heart, but I know it. And the lost those who won't come back. You stretch yourself to me and I reach towards you with one hand and with the other out to sea. It is the moment we pause and listen to ourselves, knowing for that moment only something. And for you, I will extend the time, keep the time, beat the time as the pulse of me, inner, to this, the rhythm of ours and the us we share, knowing ourselves and another form, forgiveness, and allow the tired self to rest the brief pause of surrender before stretching then, stretching with and through ourselves in the moment we can extend, take form, take what we are inside and make ourselves as islands for us to walk from point to point to point across the reaches of the sea. And I think I might just leave it at that. Thank you very much.
I think you probably went over slightly, but that was very good. I enjoyed that.
Thank you.
The second one. Thank you.
Thanks.
Big hand for Leslie Constable, who came in from a late bus and jumped straight onto Zoom. Marvellous. Okay. So without further ado, we come to our first feature of the evening. So Jake Wildeman is a hopeless romantic and occasional angry young man native to Nottingham, with a built-in inclination to cover the words of songwriters alongside his own poetry. He made his performance debut on Poetry Is Dead Good stage at Hockley Castle 2016. Jake has been a fixture on open mic nights in and around the city ever since, at least until that their pandemic happened. He became a member of the DIY Poets Collective and co-host of Crosswords Open Mic over the following year. He has taken his poems to his events as far as Southwell, Derby, Leicester and Birmingham, and also briefly ran a regular lyrics appreciation event by the name of Poetry Undercover. By this point in life, he is content to crawl out of the woodwork every so often to perform, though one can only guess the flavour of his set. Caffeine-driven, impotent rage, soppy bollocks love poetry, neo-Gothic misery, or maybe even something genuinely heartfelt. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Jake Wildeman.
Hello, hello. Oh, well, that was nice. Thank you for that, Peter. Okay, so I got something interesting for you. I never edit poetry, ever. It doesn't happen. When I write poems, I just write them once and then they're done. So to bring you a set that is basically all edits is very strange for me. And I'm going to start with the only piece I haven't changed. This is one of my favorites of my own stuff, and it's called I Played Gabriel. I always played Gabriel in my childhood nativities. Year upon year, it was only ever me, the one of the boys who wanted to be an angel. You could see it in the short, tight, white, blonde curls I used to wear, the innocence there locked between the locks. Within the halls of primary school, I played prayer leader, wrote the words that others spoke in reverence or obligation or fear of a teacher's disapproval. In fact, most of them probably mouthed my words, but that's not the point. I wanted to serve something more than myself. Back then, it was the task of being more than I was. As I got older, you'd see it in the neatly tucked shirt and the fact that I wore a tie properly despite not knowing how to knot it myself. It manifests as a keen desire for cleanliness and a squeamishness for blood. It shows in a predisposition for chasing a higher purpose in the worship of work and bosses, family, an older brother I respect to the point of adopting all of his worst traits as well as his best. Love and romance. The process of romanticism has become one of idol building, keeping me idle as I search for answers everywhere except within. When I hit my teens, I played the devil's advocate and devout Satanist, wrapped myself in a cloak of Sabbathian funeral dirges, embroidered with twisting lines of existential philosophy and cut with gems of rage, bright enough to make the betrayer himself blush. I'd found myself by then and became insular, for I was the sun, and they all orbited my light. But in the end, I was a very bad Satanist, because ultimately I was still kneeling, this time into an image that the bullies and the popular kids and even my friends had painted long before we got to secondary school. They needed a villain, or a monster, or, to bring it to its core, an other. So I obliged once again. Bent my head to the whims of men. I was different for them. I'm still playing Gabriel now, again and again, a thousand different adaptations of the Nativity, herald of whichever savior and speaker for whichever god. Maybe this time, though, I'm playing Gabriel for me. Maybe this time it's not just because I'm the one of the boys that wants to be an angel. Maybe it's because I want to be an angel for myself. Thank you. Okay. Our next couple come from a workshop I did in, I think, 2020 or 2021. They just seem to have meshed together somehow. A workshop I did with the lovely Leanne Moden, who, if you don't know Leanne Moden, chase her up. She's marvelous. And as I say, these are all from this point on edits of stuff I've already done. So this is Perception. I am an open door, a wound in the wall, an arch between two places. Defiance, a function designed to separate, desiring to let you in. I have hinges which hold me steady even when swung from one state to another. Fluid like water, multifaceted, dual-faced, to gaze always at the beholder. I wear cracks for my makeup, let light shine through edges even when closed off to the world. I have a canvas to receive carving or gentleness just the same. I am a handle, waiting for the embrace of some strange hand. Anticipation manifest. Thank you.
Wow.
This next piece is slightly more colorful in its imagery. It's called The Death of Winter. See it in color, blossoming the same as messes on pale teenage flesh. Former snowscapes riddled through. Elms and vampires wake, feed upon ice-white sunshine. Bodies back to routine bring with them heat and friction. Umber cigarette embers on pavement tiles, ugly tea leaf fortune stains. Down, like all the Christmas decor, the change drunk stagger bloody, pumping into a new day, a new season. Winter, found himself lynched in the market square, strung up by the mob seeking out their very own fresh start. Sat in a coffee house, I wonder, may we have simply stayed frozen? For I have felt nothing but cold since winter died. Thank you. And next piece, we have a edit I did in 2019. This one's got some fun context. This is an edit of the first poem I ever read at an open mic night, titled The Moon's Gone Away. And I visited Derby, where I don't know if anyone ever went to see it, the gigantic moon they had in Derby Cathedral. It goes on tour every once in a while, I'm told the moon does. But they had it in Derby, and few poets were doing a perform, and I decided, hey, I've got a poem about the moon, I'll go do my moon poem. I shuffled it around a little bit. Now, this is The Moon's Gone Away. It's freezing black. Fingers type numb, and my feet only exist every other moment. I am arrested by the lights, those small persisting spots, and the wondrous thing that is slowly swallowed out of my view. Think of how fleeting it can be, how easily, passively even, that orb was taken, and how curiously I watched, how I could but watch. Things often change and sometimes even disappear, yet still I cling to this last sliver of silver. Stay with me. I don't want to be alone. At least might I sleep a while so as to avoid being without you. Tapestry of the heavens themselves, must you go? Can we not speak for an eternity? You do not judge. You are a friend. Your darkness and your light, all is as comfort. You hide your face behind a shroud of deepest sanguine, and yet I remain entwined to see it peel away once more. My questions are met wordlessly by your reflective face. Matching my gaze, I have forgotten myself. My body is resting in the chill, mind elsewhere with you. Blood moon amidst ocean of stars. Warm hearts sit by my side in spirit, others lie sleeping in their beds, broken by the day, a moment away, a lifetime, yet here I perceive them all, carried with me in my words. They fill my pages, these lights in my sky. I look at the shapes, the patterns, trace them together. The web transcends us, humanity, my circle of friends and family. You fade and shift and dissipate, blood moon, as do they all. The sky will change, and we can't stop it. Whatever it was that veiled your face, turned you red. And the horizon simmers in scarlet, as both celestial body and I surrender to the coming dawn. Thank you. For my final piece of this run, I shall, if I can, share my screen with you to show you a single piece, a very short piece, but a piece twice over, called Ironmonger's Pond. I wrote this initially as a single poem, and I've basically turned it into two. Is everyone able to see that? Beautiful. I'm going to read the version on the left, but you will notice that both of these pieces run concurrently. It's two different ways of looking at the end of a very meaningful relationship. Ironmonger's Pond. There are memories sunk to the bottom, like wishing coins. There's no skipping herself, a stone over the surface, the lake's too deep, a reliquary for all the love she found below those gentle ripples. She wonders inside if her pennies still shine as bright, after 3 years drown in fresh water. Maybe it's just the moonlight, but she holds herself tight in the cold by the shallows, ironmongers laced with stars tonight. She holds her head up, just high enough to see the sky, counting them through teary eyes. And that's it. How do I get back? How do I get back? There we go. Beautiful. I know how technology works. Oh, there we have it.
Wow. Thank you, Jay.
Thank you.
That was brilliant. You haven't got another one of it.
I could dig something up. I can pick up a surprise poem. Bear with me.
Call it an encore.
We'll call it an encore.
I suggest you play guitar, but just...
Oh, God, no. Oh, okay. This is one I haven't performed in a long, 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 long time. This was my first, trip alone to another city. I forget where... It was Birmingham. I went to Birmingham, and I spent the night in a McDonald's because I missed my train back to Nottingham. And there was a homeless young woman in the McDonald's with me. And I ended up writing this piece about her. Soft. She is soft and comes to a McDonald's at 2 a.m, looking for coffee and maybe some shelter. Carries with her little, save for pocket change, a loose blanket and a carrier bag containing her whole world. Her hair is like spun gold, her eyes more fragile than the finest cut crystal glass, wrapped in shades of grey and pain. Shame marks her as plainly as the red around her iris. She is so soft. When she sits, the man across from her moves to a different seat. There is a moment of outrage before realization that I'm no better. It took but a moment, a cursory glance, to know that here tonight she needs whatever help can be offered. How much longer did it take to ask, "Are you okay? Is there anything I can do for you? Even if it's just sitting with you." She was so soft, and I've turned her into a subject, a thing to be written about and pitied, instead of doing what I can for her. Telling her story is important, but here, tonight, potentially saving her life, is that a thousandfold. She is soft. Gentle features showing frustration as she speaks, in dire need of sleep, tapping her feet to the music as much for precious little warmth. Now, though, she also has company. And that makes the night easier, if only to the point of possibility. If only she could always have company. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Jake. Brilliant. Can you... Yeah, drum roll, Jason. can you unmute, please, and give Jake Wildeman a big hand? Thank you.
Just amazing. Yes, bravo.
We go back into the full screen.
Wonderful.
Are you pinned, Jason?
No, it should be back to normal if you click on the, the dots and go to gallery. Yeah,
thank you very much, Jake. That was excellent. And I like the last one. I like the one. It reminded me something about Haruki Murakami's book, After Dark. I don't know if anybody's ever read that. It's about one night and this guy meets this girl in a bar, in a cafe, and they sort of, it's a story, but it's brilliant. And one of my favorite books. Brilliant. Thank you, Jake. Okay, so we're going to take a break now. It's 8 o'clock, so let's be back at 8:10, and then we're going to follow that with the incredible Derek Dohren. I mean, what more can you say? This is, and we've already had an ode to bus drivers, and now we've got the man.
And I see tickets, please.
Of his set list, because he posted it on Facebook. Cool. Take a break, get yourself a cup of tea, and we'll see you at 8:10, please. Thank you very much. And we're now recording. So, Derek Dohren, Derek Dohren's spirit of mild curiosity is born out of fanciful whims. That's not always a good thing. After his most recent ill-fated adventuring resulted in him spending a couple of months driving buses on the Isle of Skye, Derek has returned to trundling his people carriages through the Forest of Dee. He rolls with life's punches, and no matter where this leads him, his head remains determinedly in the clouds. Sorry, I've just lost my place, which is not very good, is it? None of this sits particularly well with his pen. So he rolls with life's punches, and no matter where this leads him, his head remains determinedly in the clouds. None of this sits particularly well with his passengers, but they are generally a patient lot, and most of them aren't paying anyway. Might need to explain that one, Derek. Much like his driving, Derek can be as direct as a ransom note, or can spin out tales that take you on a long journey. Either way, he delivers without fail. His two poetry collections, Everything Rhymes with Orange and Wasp in My Cockpit, both published by Black Eyes, are a celebration of his unique style, described by one commentator as quietly subversive. Signed copies are available at Derek's website, www.derekdohren.com/apps/webstore. I'm sure he will post that on the chat after he's finished his set. So without further ado, can I now hand you over to the magnificent Derek Dohren?
Thank you, Peter. Thank you very much. I'm going to start with a bit of a sordid confession. I've got a weather girl crush, the biggest since records began. Thermal ridges upwelling on her occluded front. I want a flash flood, my waterspouts already swelling. I've got a weather girl crush, the hottest since records began. A cyclonic rotation, tropical convergence zones, heavy risk of cyclones, stratospheric oscillation. I've got a weather girl crush, the longest since records began. The forecast looks bleak, a tropical depression, some moisture advection. It's gonna get wetter next week. I've got a weather girl crush, the wettest since records began. Convective instability, my jet streams veered north. I'm going to pour forth with extremely high humidity. Thank you. I'm not naming any names. A while ago, I had a very high maintenance friend stay with me for a few days. That turned into a couple of weeks. And it was a very educational time. I wrote this poem about it. It's called, Is It Best to Leave Some Things? When you left, I paused. A sweep of the brush ought to do it, or so at least I thought. The empty toppled bottles of shampoo, strange items of clothing, discarded, abandoned. An alien had landed on the White House lawn. I'm brushing out the flat. But if I get too close, there is a pixelation of detail. When I'm further away, perspective is gained, and I can scan the traces differently. Is it best to leave some things unswept? We saved one another briefly. A mapped out plan ought to do it, or so at least I thought. Packets of food beyond understanding, PDF docs and movie files devoured, digested. I no longer trust what words are for. I'm sweeping out my heart to tidy space for yours, Anna, where Lanzarote meets the world. When you're further away, perspective is lost, but impression comes into focus. Is it best to leave some things unkempt? Thank you. Here's a little one about a couple I met in a pub. It's called Di and Diana. I was down in the pub with Di and Diana. They're both Christians. They explained that before they were born, they'd effectively been as dead as doornails, were then born only to die, to be born again, so that when they died again, they would be saved from death by a man who had never been born and had always existed, but who was then born anyway, in order to die, to be born again, to go to heaven, but without dying. All during the time, Di and Diana were dead, but long before they were born, had died, been born again, and would die again. Di and Diana had also been dying to get to heaven in each of their lives. Di told me that one day after he had died again, after having been dead, been born, died, then born again, he believed he would be born again, again. I hope you're keeping up. Di hoped to be able to share dialogue with the dead again and born again again Diana and tell their four dead again grandparents in heaven, now born again again, after having been effectively as dead as doornails, been born, died, then born again and died again, all about it. I asked Diana what she thought. She said, oh, call me Di. Everyone else does. I said, doesn't that get confusing? And if looks could kill. I offered to buy another round, but Di declined. It's dead in here, he said. I said, hang on, let me get a pen and write this down. There's a killer poem in this. Thank you. Yes, that's just a little bit of silliness. Something a bit more serious, I guess. In 2018, I was part of a group of poets who were invited to write and perform poetry at the Gustav Holst Museum in Cheltenham. A great honor, you know, and the museum is basically in the house where he lived. And we were each assigned a planet to write about, and we were given a room to perform our poem in. And we had to perform the poem to members of the public as they walked around the museum. I was assigned Pluto, which was a bit odd because there is no Pluto in Holst's planet suite. This event was to commemorate the 100th anniversary of the first performance of the planet suite. And obviously there is no Pluto. Pluto hadn't in fact been discovered in Holst's lifetime. And of course it's not even a fucking planet anymore. Nevertheless, it was an honor. And I decided to go with the astrology angle of Pluto. And this is what I came up with. Am I the frozen dwarf or the god of the underworld? You decide. Dark white, but not quite grey. In my distracted distance, renaissance awaits. There is no cradle without a grave, no evolution of understanding, cryptic rhythms notwithstanding of that which is truly arcane, acknowledging all that is usefully insane. Release the chains of fear, the great revealer is here, frigid lost child of the sun. Who do you say that I am? Everything as it used to be, or nothing the same as it was. To the minimalist silver-tongued torturer, all art is self-portraiture. Deconstructor of construction, in whose grip all die and become swallowed in solar absolution. Am I the frozen dwarf or the god of the underworld? You decide. Pale black, but not quite grey. Do not be misled by size, for the microbe brings down the man. I have my siblings lassoed, the metamorphosis of circumstance, in elliptic mission circle dance, virtual reality broadcaster and indiscriminate puppet master. My eyes have all the measure of submission and subjugation. keeper at the gates of delirium. What does your heart speak of me? Everything as it used to be, or nothing the same as it was? Precision touchpad sorcerer, sacred geometry, conjurer, instructor of instruction, stealer, healer of endings begun, the liberator of invention, rewilding the tamed imagination. Thank you.
Wow. Love that.
Who cares that it's not a planet, you know? Okay, I'm going to write, I'm going to read this one. This is from Wasp in My Cockpit, which was is my second collection. And this is a poem about an ex-poet. It's called Phil. Here he comes now, his life in abeyance, smoothing down the tarmac in his motorized conveyance. England's Botox-faced glory. Can't work now, he's too ill. Let me tell you the story of my childhood mate, Phil. Once active on the poetry scene, he liked a bit of the spoken word. Didn't do out mucky or obscene, had a bit of a taste for the absurd. Went in for political satire, targeting the Tories and Donald Trump, expressing his scorn and his ire. But now he's defeated, sat on his rump. Ah, yes, Philip, twin batteried commuter, neutered and rooted to his chair. And to be fair, when I look at him, there's a twinge of guilt and remorse. I admit there's a cringe, a regret of sorts. But I do feel better since I bought him his scooter in the January sales. It was the least I could do for pushing him off that mountain in North Wales. We were lifetime friends after all, not that it counted for much when I stood and watched him fall after giving him a gentle nudge. We first became mates at school, went to punk gigs together. We were the epitome of cool in our tartan and our leather. We got active on the poetry scene. We liked a bit of the spoken word. Didn't do out mucky or obscene. Had a bit of a taste for the absurd. Went in for political satire, targeting the Tories and Maggie Thatcher. Expressed our scorn and our ire. We'd never be defeated by the infamous milk snatcher. But at the mic, from time to time, Phil got right on my tits with his propensity to force a rhyme with lines that just didn't fit. He wrote one about the Sex Pistols and that famous interview they did where he tried to rhyme Bill Grundy via a spurious reference to Hereford Cathedral with the Mappa Mundi. Further on in that poem, he even tried to rhyme seditious. Yeah. With young Sidney, the bass player, who's viciously no longer with us. He's forgiven me now for putting him in a state of catatonia. After all, what happens in North Wales stays in Snowdonia. But if he ever gets up on that stage again, I'm not liable for my actions. For him, it's going to be Armageddon and the rest of his life in traction. We used to be the best of mates, but he tipped me over the edge with rhymes so bad that used to grate until I shoved him off that Welsh ledge. Ah, yes, Philip, the twin batteried commuter, neutered and rooted to his chair. And to be fair, when I look at him, there's a twinge of guilt and remorse. I admit there's a cringe, a regret of sorts. And that's the sad tale of my erstwhile pal that I thought you ought to know. His life changed direction with a little deflection off a cliff top in Llandudno. Thank you. It's not actually true, that story. I feel I need to make that clear. Not all of it, anyway. Okay, here's a short one called Mea Culpa. I killed you, but I didn't mean it. Was I sad or was I just a coward? I'm not sure what my mood was, somewhere between blue and yellow, a jealous shade of green, perhaps. Mea culpa. But I don't mean it. The sun rises later now, and the sky doesn't speak to me. I'm stuck at the lights, somewhere between yellow and red, a fruity shade of orange, perhaps. I'll go and vote, but I won't mean it. I'll hold a minute's silence, then spoil my ballot paper. I'm not sure what the choices are, somewhere between red and blue. A regal shade of purple, perhaps. I killed you, but I didn't mean it. Okay, thank you. Where are we? Okay, so you might be expecting a bus driver poem from me. Bus driving, just to crush a few myths. It's not all glamour. It can be challenging at times. And one thing that drivers hate the most is the unexpected detour, especially the ones that are passed on to us en route. And normally we receive these in quite a dry manner, and almost in a confusing way. A lot of the B roads around where I drive seem to be made up of the digits 2 and 4. And it's hellishly difficult trying to figure out where you are supposed to be going when you've got a bus full of passengers and you're in a double decker and you're terrified you're going to hit a low bridge and all the rest of it. This one's called Diversions Are in Place. The B4224 at Lee is closed for flood defence work. Diversions are in place. Pull into the bus stop at Lee Church, then reverse into Orchard View. Return to the junction of the B2244 and the B2422 and take the first left for the B2244. Continue down the B2244 to the Crown Inn and turn right onto the B4244. Continue to Longhope and turn right at the Nag's Head to rejoin the B4224. I receive an update. The B2424 into Gloucester is closed for pothole repair work. Diversions are in place. All traffic normally entering Gloucester from the B2424 is to divert down the B4422. Continue down the B4224 and turn left at the Red Lion to join the B4422. Continue on to Gloucester. At Gloucester Transport Hub, I'm unable to park in my allocated bay because another bus is already there. I divert to the adjacent slot and annoy the driver coming in behind me because I'm now in his bay. He is forced to divert accordingly. We acknowledge one another and smile behind our masks, but inside we are quietly seething. Before I leave the hub, I check for updates. Sheep are on the road on the B2442. There's a sinkhole in Horwithy on the B4242 and subsidence in Sling on the B2224. There are potatoes at Peterstow all across the newly reopened section of the B4424. There's been a landslide at Cambridge and the B4442 is closed. BT are ripping up the pavements on the B2242. Tree felling and hedge cutting is taking place all along the B4244. Expect delays. And on the messages come. A nuclear submarine has beached on the B2222. Aliens have landed on the B4444. A woolly mammoth has shit itself outside the Dog and Muffler pub in English Bicknor on the B2442. And that's why there are temporary traffic lights in operation at the junction of the B2444 and the B4222. Diversions are in place. I arrive back at Ross-on-Wye 224 minutes late and retire to the restroom. I fish out a coin and feed it into the vending machine before I see the post-it note that reads, machine fucked, and I lose my 50p. I smile behind my mask, but quietly I am seething inside. Thank you.
Absolute class.
And that is a true story. That actually happens. Okay, I'm going to finish with an old one rehashed, which some of you may remember a version of this from my early days performer around Gloucester. It's called Broccoli Cockney. Broccoli Cockney, Lancashire Hotpot, Liberace, Hockney Millionaire's Yacht, Lancelot, Camelot, Lewis Capaldi, Gigawatt, Mandelbrot, Fibonacci, Osama, Obama, 72 Virgins, 9/11, Straight to Heaven, Nicola Sturgeon, Monte Carlo, Acapulco, Internet Troll, Bollywood, Hollywood, the Grassy Knoll, Winfrey, the Dimblebees, Television Royalty, Attenborough, Erinsborough, Tesco Club Card Loyalty, Transatlantic, Titanic, Unsinkable Molly, Marc Chagall, Louis Van Gaal, Stan and Ollie, Trainspotter, Harry Potter, Guacamole, Forrest Gump, Donald Trump, Ravioli, Fidel Castro, Chairman Mao, Morecambe and Wise, Auschwitz, Fake Tits, Betty Davis Eyes, Vital Organ, Piers Morgan, Grammar Nazi, Hannah Montana, Princess Diana, Paparazzi, Che Guevara, Ava Gardner, Elon Musk, Number 10, Eminem, Donald Tusk, Bruno Mars, Ringo Starr, Mahatma Gandhi, Mandala, Mandela, Ariana Grande, Fukushima, Dua Lipa, Peter Pan, T-Rex, Malcolm X, the Ku Klux Klan, Wills and Kate, Will and Grace, Philip Coutinho, Happy Hour, Sweet and Sour, Jose Mourinho, Meghan Markle, Miss Marple, Botticelli, On the Dole, Northern Soul, Lionel Messi, Game of Thrones, Kidney Stones, Peanut Butter, Hyperspace, Human Race, In the Gutter. Thank you very much. That's me done.
Thank you very much, Derek. Wow.
Thank you.
Go on mute, please, and give Lauren a huge round of applause, please. Thank you. So everybody's probably rolling around on the floor now. BT44 and the mammoth shit. That's the best one for me. And the aliens have landed. That's
only a matter of time.
Hey, how's your internet?
How's my internet?
Kate, how is your internet?
It seems all right.
Okay. Are you all right? Because I've got you down, not next, but I was just checking whether you needed to pump forward. You're okay, eh?
Yeah. No, it's okay.
Okay.
It probably won't be when I perform, but hey.
Just smile. Yeah. Okay. So from that, somebody's got to follow that. And unfortunately, Gerald, it's you. Where is he?
Hiya.
In front of all those boxes and CDs and books and records, yeah, and stuff that you're sorting out. I'm surprised you've got any time to read poetry.
I do. I'm going to do, I think I might get three in religious poems. This is called Malachi. It's about the last book of the Old Testament. At the end of the Old Testament, God is still unsure of himself, still unaware, still in the 60s, teeming with complex ideas and songs about gnomes. Doesn't yet know he will become David Bowie, the superstar. That complex prophecies will be swept away by simple songs, that a bastard child will outstrip his fame, will fill out Wembley Stadium and Jerusalem. In a weeping garden, Judas waits, that most disgruntled fan. At the end of the Old Testament, there's a whiff of success, but nothing is yet certain. Poor Malachi, last track on the album before mega stardom. That's about the last book in the Bible. This is about when I used to be religious and go around telling people about God. And it's called A Meeting in Roots Hall. I remember as a student knocking on hall doors to tell people about Jesus. And there was this girl came to the door in a towel, flushed because they were having sex. And I was stupid and embarrassed as she sent me away. I wonder what happened to that moment, where it now sits, or if it sits anywhere at all, if there is a relationship or a child. Or a divorce with small acrimonies, maybe just a stain. forgotten, as was the naive supplicant holding a Bible at the door as if it contained love. Anna, just because I'm going to do stuff about this again, I'm going to finish with one from my book called Counting the Days. They're talking about Revelation on the next table. He's a cafe. They're talking about Revelation on the next table. He brings up beasts and sacrifices and lambs, explains the intricacies of an exposition that goes back to J.N. Darby and my teenage years. He doesn't know who J.N. Darby is, nor does she. Yet out of ancient texts, out of antique words, their meaning lost in the politics of ancient Rome and the persecution of a sect of fanatics in catacombs and caves, he brings forth dreams, prophecies of a world that's yet to come, turned violent and wild, terrifying yet free. His vision spins outward like a Catherine wheel, demons cast down as new gods are drawn in. I'm waiting for my black bean soup. They're waiting for the end of days. Thank you. And that's from 51 Poems.
Thank you, Gerald. Okay, moving on. Did everybody give a nice big hand to Gerald there, please? Just making sure you're all awake. Moving on to Rose Leonard, please.
Thanks. This is called One Way to See an Otter. I will take you to a place I know. We'll wait for the incoming tide to lift the slick, flat strands of kelp, for the soft salt water to run its gentle fingers through the weed, opening spaces for a hunter's tumble turns, while we hunker downwind, scentless and hidden, waiting. Field glasses poised. And maybe in that stillness, where the breathing loch is easy and the oyster catchers rest, a slight splash, the way the silken water parts around a shape, dark, that could be rock or bladder rack, but for its grace and purpose, will capture our attention. And breathless, we will watch as she ties our hearts in knots, binds them in the ribbons of her flow, as she goes about the business of an otter. Diving, catching crabs, rising sleek upon a boulder, the fierce way her killer's teeth make a mess of shell and flesh, pink tongue as she crunches open-jawed, muzzle haloed by a bristle of whiskers. Her coat breaking into spikes, a long lithe arc of hunched spine. How she lifts her tail to sprint, slips quickly back under the sea loch's silver skin. And you will never be the same again. You will go back into your life like one who has glimpsed a ghost or been visited by angels. Shaken by the intimation of a truth more vital, undone by the press of nature's palm upon your chest. Thank you.
Wow. Another one?
No, that's all for tonight.
Okay. Big hand for Rose Leonard, please.
Thanks.
I like the way you read. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, moving on. She's moved on my screen, so I went the way you were and you've moved. You haven't moved your caravan, have you?
No, I haven't moved.
still on that cliff top.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I could go off the edge any moment.
Okay, try and finish your poems first. Thank you. Kate Jenkinson, please. Thank you.
Thank you. So I attended workshop that was run by Leanne recently, and she introduced me to nonets, which are 9 line poems, and they decline in syllable length from 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So they're quite short. So there's a couple of nonets to start with. And then she also taught me a trimeric, which is an interesting form. And I'll see if you can work out what the pattern is. And then I'll finish with a poem about hope. So three short ones. Cycling uphill in wind is a pain. Even worse when it rains and my eyebrows leak rain in my eyes. Gusts from the side make me swerve wildly wide. Brakes screech, lights flash, hear the crash. I stop dead. And a more light nonette.
Mm-hmm.
I used to have a woolen nanette. I couldn't pronounce my B's, so nanette it was. I needed her to sleep quietly. I lost her once, found in snow, so cold. I hugged her tight that night. And then the trimeric is four lines, and then three of the second, third, and fourth line start their verses. So here's the trimeric. If I win £1 million, then I tell you, I wouldn't want to travel. I'd stay where my feet are grounded and I would make good of all the ills. I wouldn't want to travel because I wouldn't want to waste the possibilities £1 million afforded me. I'd stay where my feet are grounded so my imagination could fly free and find a way to better serve society. And I would make good of all the ills. I would find a way to spend £1 million in 1 million creative healing ways. Mm. So that's, they were good fun. And then I would like to leave you with a bit of hope, because I was going to read something about what's happening in the wider world, and I thought this poem maybe alludes to it. So it's called Hope. I'd like to grasp the word hope, but the sharp possibilities are razor blades incising my past from my future, and hope the bridge in between, shaking and rattling my nerves, slowly shattering, and hope, although etched in my brain, finds no fertile place in my heart. And my hand extends with my veins stretched blue and exposed on my wrist. I shrug. Is it easier to end this or exist with the pain? Well, even hope with its hurting is worth me exerting myself beyond the all too familiar, familial fear. I sense hope is near. I'd like to grasp the familiarity of hope, for when hope seemed to have abandoned me, poetry stood by, ever there to find the words I couldn't hear. Poetry reminded me that hope surges when pessimism pours cold water on the fire of adventure. Hope sizzles and spits her furious desire to be relit, relit. Hope is the sunset on an imperfect day, the sleeping rays resting and re-energizing, darkness consuming all our fears. So in the morning, hope dawns and reappears. She accompanies me in every new and challenging experience, her belief and sheer resilience to cope with life's ups and downs. I feel her gentle presence. Hope holds my hand and whispers affirmations. Her reassurance understands, recharging my determination to survive, inspiring my curiosity. And when I wonder whether I can keep going, hope, somehow now knowing that darkness is near, she reaches back to hold my hand. She keeps me alive. Thank you.
Thank you, Kate. Big hand for Kate. Thank you, Kate. Yeah, we've alluded to it now, haven't we? So it's a difficult one. My late first wife was actually half Ukrainian. Her father was a Ukrainian. And so my eldest two children are part Ukrainian. My grandchildren are all part Ukrainian. So it's a bit close to home. We're all watching and just terrified of what's going to happen. But it all seems to be, the Ukrainians seem to be doing really well. And you can't imagine how they are holding back that enormous power. Okay, I'm not going to say anymore. I'm going to move on to Agatha Palmer, who again has a very close connection to Ukraine, because I believe you were born in Poland, which is the country borders. My late father-in-law was actually born on the border between Poland and Ukraine. So at various times where he was born was in Poland, and other times it was in Ukraine, because those borders moved around a bit at times. I understand, anyway, that's what I was told. But anyway, sorry, I sort of just feel like I've just put you on the spot, Agatha, there. But
thank you.
Thank you. Right, okay, I've got a small one and a not so small one. This first one is about loss. It's called My King. A proud lion roamed, master of his savannah, until heat faded. His thunderous belly stirred black clouds when challenged, fell on savage ground. Beneath crushing jaws, the crave of second chances wept like bush willow. Eyes closed to sunfall, rest at a waterhole, you became water. Always my king, the pad of drums on dusted plains, I still feel your roar. My last one is written for all you poets, and it's about the pressures of writing, and it's called Cage Fright. I have a fear of falling, and I'm scared of heights. Yet I seek a prize on a paper mountain. At the top, there is a cage that hangs off a ledge. Inside lies a laurel crown. I step inside to write landscapes. If I dare to look down, words will escape, drain me of ink. As I climb, steps are pressured. I should tread with care, or I'll lose my grip. With the rise in altitude, risks can be deadly. A gust of sentiment to throw my balance. I could trip over adjectives. If I don't listen to the beat of feet, I may not pause in a safe space for breath. If I fail to punctuate the route, I may slip off an edge. If I am reckless, I could misjudge gaps of understanding. Spare slack to metaphor, give myself rope burns. If I lose my footing, I'll feel the crush of criticism. The air is thin and I hear voices. They echo, you don't belong here. Those words are familiar. The cage rattles, my pen drops. I have a fear of falling. I'm caged and exposed, but my cage is self-imposed. Thank you.
Thank you, Jason. Big hand for Jason Conway. Jason is the tech savvy person of the GPS. Currently in the middle of doing an MA and just recovered from COVID. So, doing well. Okay, so now we come to the end of the evening, and we come to I don't know what. Because this person, we tend to put Clive at the end, not because, we don't know where else to put him, but just he's a difficult act to follow. And I love sort of the way we end the night with something completely crazy. He's probably going to do something very serious now, just to fool me. But anyway, you know who he is. So here he is, Clive Osmond. Thank you.
Yeah, so thanks for that, Peter. Yeah, I have just written a very serious poem and I decided to I have actually written a very serious poem. I'm not trying it to go on. Right, okay. So there are a few people that have heard this already. They've already had this inflicted upon them. And I'm apologising to them in advance that you're gonna hear it again. So they will know what's coming straight away. When I ask the question, are there any Victor Borger fans in the audience? The great Victor Borger. Obviously he's long gone. You know, I mean, he is long gone. But I remember seeing him as a kid on the telly and thinking he was absolutely hilarious. Forgot all about him, as you do. And then genuinely, in the space of 24 hours recently, I had two friends recommend that I should watch him because I would really like him because of the sort of stuff that amuses me. And I did, and I was utterly blown away by the man's genius. So, and I watched a clip of him doing a piece that he called Inflationary Language, where every word that has a syllable in it that sounds like a number, or any number that's used, or anything related to numbers, the number increases by one. So, for example, forehead becomes five head. Two lips, as he will pronounce it, was three lips, and so on. So you get the idea. And I thought, okay, I'm going to give that a go. And obviously, Victor Borger was a genius, and I'm not. So this, I'm not pretending this is as good as he would do, but I do enjoy doing it. I used three get on well with my neighbour. Then he suddenly accused me of five nick-nineting with his wife. I wasn't one and a half angry. I called him a master of niner, and he properly went five me, lunged at me in anger. I hit him on the five head with the sharp thrill. A passing motorist threeted his horn, and I think they called the police, panicked and dialed 10-10-10. The coppers arrived, full blues and threes, and I was arrested and charged with using unreasonable fives. I was sentenced to 4 months in prison, but served one and a half of the sentence, five good behaviour. I was released just before Christmas. You know, that 13-day period when people, five last Christmas, you know, that 13-day period when people talk about the four wise men and five's ridiculous amounts of food and drink inside themselves. On 539, I had nine all this nonsense. I celebrated my release by going to a burger place, not Six Guys, way through it, way three expensive, and enjoying a 1¼ pounder with a glass of eight up. Now, my eyesight is not perfect. I definitely don't have 21/21 vision. I'm a bit of a specky five eyes, but I'd swear the bloke opposite me was the England rugby player, Billy 13 Trees. Then this German guy approached me and said, "Sprechen Sie Deutsch?" I said, 10. That confused him. I went home and listened to a Spotify playlist consisting of some classics from the 61s, the 71s and the 81s. Love Me 11er by Elvis, 9 Days a Week by the Beatles, Ruby Three's Day by the Rolling Stones, You're the Two That I Want from Greece, Tricycle Race by Queen, and Swords of 1001 Men by 11 Pole Three Door. Now, I'm going to walk my five-legged K10 friend, Rover, get some exercise to get myself a seven-pack. Then I've got some books to read. The Triography of the late Archbishop Desmond III, and two about the curse of Tutankhamun's Stream. The second time I read this, someone said it was rubbish and not at all funny. "Hang on, two-third," I shouted. So they did. 11 thirds later, they said, "OK, I've examined it five forensically and it's still garbage." So it was back 3-2. Second and five most, it must be funny. I Tudor if this version is better. Thank you, and Threedle Pip. Thank you very much. And that was a slightly older version, which I only realised halfway through. That's why I sort of stumbled over my words a little bit, because that, I've edited it since then, and that was the old version. So.
Thank you, Clive. Give a round of applause to Clive, please. Thank you. Wow. Okay, so that brings us to the end of our evening. I'd like to have a big... Please unmute yourself, everybody. And can we have a big round of applause for everybody that did open mic tonight? Can we have a big round of applause for Jake Wildeman, please? And a big round of applause, please, for Derek Dohren. Thank you. Wonderful. Okay, we're done. You'll be pleased to know that Josephine will be back next month. The post for next month, which features Anna Saunders and Belinda Rimmer, will be posted tomorrow. So you can, if you want to do open mic on that, you need to get in because I think it's going to be busy. And can we also say, mind you, that next Tuesday, International Women's Day, 7 o'clock on Zoom, post is on the Facebook page, Raise Voices, 22 amazing poets, some of whom are actually here now. So thank you. Good night.
Good night. Thank you very much.